When you woke up, was the television on?
Yes, it was.
And did you happen to see something on the news?
Yes, I did.
At that point in time, did you learn that a teenager had been killed at the Gate gas station?
Yes, I did.
Did you then tell the defendant that you wanted to go home?
Yes, I did.
And why did you decide that you wanted
to? Well, there you see the fiance on the stand crying. You know, she's crying today in court. She's crying when she's on the stand, but she wasn't crying that night. The night that a boy, Jordan Davis, was gunned down, sitting in his car. And I'm going to bring in John Phillips, the attorney for the family of Jordan Davis. Mr. Phillips, thank you for being with us. You know, they brought on Jordan Davis's father today, which I thought was horribly cruel to do, to suggest that the other three boys came over to Davis's home to get their story straight. And now they're attacking police, saying that the boys threw a gun out. That's not what happened. That is not what happened, according to police, John. Police say that he shoots the boy in the back, shoots him three times. They speed off as Dunn continues to fire after them. Then they realize there is his headstone. 17, he's got a headstone. How wrong is that? So then they realize that Jordan is shot. They try to reach for him and blood is all over their hands. They turn around and go straight back to that gas station to try to get help. And people pull Davis out and try to resuscitate him. You're seeing funeral footage right now of this boy, a 17-year-old, sitting in his car unarmed. And now the defense, John Phillips, is trying to argue that the boys really took off so they could throw their shotgun out of the car. I mean, there's no evidence of that, John.
There's not. And these are good middle-class kids. These aren't the type of kids that ran like that. I mean, they were just listening to loud music, having gone girl shopping, you know? It's the all-American teenager's day. And then Michael Dunn takes offense. And like you pointed out a little earlier, he didn't say, don't point your gun at me like that or don't threaten me like that. He said, you're not going to talk to me like that, and then open fire. And you know, how about the hypocrisy of him complaining that these boys didn't call 911 exactly according to his time clock when Michael Dunn and Rhonda Rau were never even bothered to pick up their phone?
With me is John Phillips, the attorney for the Jordan Davis family, joining me out of Jacksonville. And in the last hours in court, the defense actually called the boy's father to the stand for the defense. I don't know how he... I mean, it's been 30 years since I had to take the stand in my fiance's murder trial. I still remember it like it was yesterday, and I don't know why they had to do that to this man. With me also, Daryl Parks, civil rights lawyer for Trayvon Martin's family. You know, Daryl, when I hear them start to crucify these boys, they didn't do anything. I was reading this article about how they were all trying to get ready and put on cologne and do their hair to go to the mall to try to meet girls. And it just broke my heart. When I think of my son, who is only 6 now, doing something as innocent as trying to meet girls at a mall, and then this happens, they did not have a gun, Daryl.
And Nancy, I have to agree. You know, when you think about the mentality of Mr. Dunn, when he said he hates this type of thug music, the mentality he had even before he saw those kids, he knew in his mind that he probably didn't like them and went after them the way he did. Jordan Davis, in no way, shape, form, or fashion, should be dead. And as you saw his grave at 17 years old, this is a tragedy.
And with me, John Phillips, the attorney for Jordan's family. You know, John, did the father know that the defense was going to call him to the stand?
No, it was a surprise. Even the prosecutors afterwards came up and apologized and said, you know, we exchanged witnesses, but he never told us that he was going to do that. It was a complete surprise. You know, more conspiracy theory by Corey Strolla. If he doesn't, you know, I hope he does that in the public forum, because we're going to slap a defamation suit on him, which
it's just not right to victimize the victim. And I'm just telling you, John, it being up on the stand and having to relive what happened like that is extremely traumatic to call his father. I was looking at a picture of his father. putting the tie on Jordan Davis. He looked like he was about 15 maybe, and it just nearly broke my heart. And now here he is testifying in the case where his son is murdered. I'm just, there you go. When I saw that, it just makes me think of getting my own son, you know, ready for church on Sunday mornings or something. It's just, and then I look at his headstone. I just don't know how the father held it together on the stand, John.
He's a man of great courage, and he, you know, it's been a long year and a half, as Mr. Parks knows from walking with Trayvon's family. You know, this is a tough road, and I was just staring at him, you know, helpless to be able to put conviction in his heart to do well by Jordan, and he did. You know, it's a love story of a fantastic family, and I'm glad America's getting to see the real truth behind
Jordan
Davis.
Well, I got to tell you something, John. There wasn't a thing you could do except sit back and let the defense do what they did to Jordan's father. There was nothing you could do to stop it. Everybody, when we come back, stepmommy and